Here we are, another Easter Sunday, Resurrection Day. I don't know about you, but I'm excited because God has done it again. He has brought us to this time of worship on Easter Sunday morning, on Resurrection Day. And I want you to join me for a moment in a response to me. The response is, I'll say, he's risen. You say, he is risen indeed. Are you ready? He is risen.
He is risen.
He is risen.
He has risen.
He has risen.
He has risen.
Give God a hand of praise. Praise his holy name.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Good morning, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. Father God, we thank you, Lord God, that we can come to you today, Father God, and we can rejoice and we can thank you for what you've done on Calvary's cross. Lord God, Friday was a dark day, Father God, but Lord, when you went to that cross, you didn't think about yourself. The first thing you said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Father God, please forgive us, for we have done so many things that we know we were wrong and some we did not know. But we thank you, Father, for your precious blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, that cleanses all sins and make us white as snow. We thank you for that precious blood that can take away that dark stain, that ugly spot in our lives and make us white and pure. We thank you. Lord God, we thank you so much that we can share the gospel with others that do not know you and are free partner in their sins. Lord God, if there's anyone that is listening today, that is worshiping with us today, that is uncertain about their salvation, Lord, please let them understand what Jesus done, that they may have a right to heaven, that they may have life and have life more abundantly. Father God, you hung on that cross, and for your stripes when they beat you, you said that we were healed. Lord, someone is sick today and they need to be healed. Lord God, please touch the bodies, Father God. Please even touch the mind. So many people are in mental stage this day and they need to be set free, Father God. Your stripes can heal them, Father. And Lord God, there is so much ugliness in this world. Your children, you told us to humble ourselves and turn from our wicked ways that you may heal our land. Bring the Christians together under one God. Help us not be Democrat or Republican. Help us to be of one God, the true and living Jesus Christ, and let us worship you and know in our hearts that we are free because you have made us free, Father God. Lord God, some mother is crying, some father is saying, save my child. Some grandmother is crying, save my grandchild. Lord God, hear their prayers, speak to that child, speak to that husband or wife that may be lost as someone is praying for. Father God, send your spirit that they may say yes, yes to you, Lord God. Lord God, tell those little children it's not about an Easter rabbit, it's about the Lamb of God that takes away all sins and heal, Father God. Help us, Lord God, to live holy and uprighteous before a holy God. And Lord God, I just say hallelujah. Thank you for what you've done on Calvary's cross. Thank you for the joy of salvation. Hallelujah. Let the word come forth today. Bless it, Father God, that it will take residence in somebody's heart, that they will repent and turn from their wicked ways. Help us, Lord God. Lift us up on a holy state in this life. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Good morning, church. Happy Easter. This morning's epistle will be taken from the from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 12 through 20. I'll be reading to you from the New King James Version, and it reads, "Now if Christ preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty, and our faith is also empty. Yes, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified to God that he raised up Christ, whom he did not raise up, if in fact the dead do not rise. For if the dead do not rise, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then also those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men the most pitiable. But now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. The word of God for the people of God.
Listen, scripture declares that music soothes the savage beast. We're getting ready for selection before the word. Let this song minister to your heart that you can be attuned to hear from God through his word. Rest in him. Listen to the words of the song so that it will soothe you. And then go into the mode of I'm going to receive a word from heaven. The next, after the selection, the next word you will hear will be from our pastor, Pastor Kevin Wilson.
Hey! hung his head. For the sins of the world, he bowed his head and he died. Ooh, yeah.
Hung his head
and he died. Oh, oh, can't you see the blood?
Jesus.
Oh, the blood.
Bowed his head.
Oh, the blood.
Christ is beyond our understanding and comprehension. He is amazing. He is awesome. He is a great God. And I am so grateful for his love of me. And I pray that you are as well. I'm going to go a different way this morning when it comes to the resurrection. I'm in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I invite you to turn there to the 15th chapter and the 12th verse. I don't know whether you've noticed or not, but Satan has been attacking the church in a substantial way in recent years. There is a lot going on in the body of Christ that if you're not reading certain materials, you will not know the attack that is taking place. And because it is, one thing I know the Word of God says that when one part of the body is hurting, it affects the whole body. And you know yourself, if there's one part in your physical body that's hurt, it affects your whole person, right? Now, many of us don't see the attacks that are coming upon us, but I have been reading and I have been seeking information that's allowing me to see that there is a lot happening in the Church of Jesus Christ in this country alone. And because it's not happening to us, so often we will miss what the enemy is trying to do in other situations. So I'm going to go a different way this morning when it comes to the resurrection. I'm going to talk about the resurrection, but I'm going to talk about it as it relates to what God is not only, well, he only did then, but what he's going to do in the days to come. So if you have your Bible, and I pray you do, I'm going to invite you to look at verse 12, 1 Corinthians 15, verse 12. And I'm reading out of the New Living Translation. If you found it in the sanctuary, say amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, beginning at verse 12. Hear the reading of the word. But tell me this, since we preach that Christ rose from the dead, why are some of you saying there is no resurrection of the dead? For if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, then all of our preaching is useless and your faith is useless. And we apostles would all be lying about God, for we have said that God raised Christ from the grave. But that can't be true if there is no resurrection of the dead. If there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is useless and you are still guilty of your sins. In that case, all who have died believing in Christ are lost. And if our hope in Christ is only for this life, we are more to be pitied than anyone in the world. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead. He is the first of a great harvest of all who have died. Amen. And my thought I want to share with you today is the resurrection dilemma. The resurrection dilemma. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for just keeping your hand of grace upon us. Thank you for being our Abba. Thank you for all that you've done for us. I ask in Jesus' name that you would move me out of the way, that the Spirit of God can do his work. And Father, I pray that you speak to all who are willing to hear. Open hearts and minds that we might receive the truth that is written in your word. Bless us, dear God, together right now. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. This is a challenging message, but it's a message that I believe God is calling me to preach today. Now, if any of you who know the epistle to the Corinthian church, you know that the church at Corinth was a hot mess. Right? Well, those of you who know, when I say they were a hot mess, they were a church that was in almost total disarray. And in fact, they were in such a situation that Paul had to write the letter to correct everything that was happening in the church. Now, my friends, I say to you today, and pray for me, that the church in America is in a hot mess. And I say that because on this Easter celebration, the enemy is wreaking havoc in the midst of the people of God. There are things that are happening that are not being seen, that are not known by many of us, but they are happening, and there are devastating consequences coming to the body of Christ in this country. You say, Reverend, what are you talking about? Well, many of you might be aware of it, but the number two, the second largest denomination in America is under a severe attack. That's the United Methodist Church. One of our sister churches, the church out of which we came as AMEs. And those of you who live in Winchester know there's almost a United Methodist Church on every corner. Somebody say amen, preacher. But the thing that many are missing and not aware of, that there is a substantial attack on that body of Christ right now. What I'm hearing is a membership of 12 million could be divided into two parts very soon. And I'm saying that to you because what we don't tend to understand is that when the enemy attacks one part of the body, it affects the whole body. And when, listen to me, when one part of the body is affected and, if you will, broken because of the attack of the enemy, you might not see it today, but it's coming our way. I know that that's not shouting words, but what I want to say today is that there is a need for us to examine ourselves and look at ourselves as the body of Christ, because if the enemy can destroy them, he can destroy us. If the enemy can divide them in such a radical way, he can come after us. And I'm saying this to you today, not because I want to, not because I'm feeling it per se, but I'm saying it because I see something coming that could hurt all of us. I'm sure someone else is sounding this alarm, but God has given me a moment to share with you today that if we don't begin to take notice that something's going to happen to us, that's happening to them. I don't know whether you know it, but I've heard there are rumblings in the Southern Baptist Convention. What in the world? How is it that these churches, these denominations that have been powerful and strong in the anointing of God and the power of God, how can they be at war? That's the thing I'm going through. How can the body of Christ be at war with itself to the degree that there are schisms and isms that are taking place in the body even as I speak? Well, the church at Corinth had a lot of mess, right? But one of the things that had happened to them was that they had begun to believe that the body of Christ would not be resurrected one day. Listen to verse 12. Listen to what Paul says to them, because he had to correct a lot of mess in this church. But look at this. Verse 12 says, "But tell me this, since we preach that Christ rose from the dead, why are some of you saying there will be no resurrection of the dead?" Now, so that we can all be on the same page, when Paul talks about the resurrection of the dead, he's not talking about the resurrection of Christ. He's talking about the resurrection of us. You're with me yet? All right, so to make it even better, I'm going to invite you to turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Chapter 4 and verse 13. So we'll all be on the same page, so you know what I'm talking about. When I talk about the resurrection, when Paul talks about the resurrection of the dead, this is what he's talking about. Chapter 4 of 1 Thessalonians and verse 13. All right, you're there? Somebody say amen. Verse 13 says, "And now, dear brothers and sisters, we want you to know what will happen to the believers who have died, so you will not grieve like people who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus Christ died, follow me, and was raised to life again, we also believe that when Jesus returns, God will bring back with him the believers who have died. We tell you this directly from the Lord. We who are still living when the Lord returns, will not meet him ahead of those who have died. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a commanding shout, and with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God. First, the believers who have died will raise from their graves. Then together with them, we who are alive, still alive, and remain on the earth will be caught up in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Then we will be with the Lord forever." So encourage each other with these words. So now, I hope we're on the same page. When Paul talks about the resurrection of the dead, he's talking about that one day Christ is going to raise those who are dead up, and those of us who belong to Christ who are alive will be changed. And I'll invite you to read the rest of 1 Corinthians chapter 15. You'll see the transformation that's going to take place. Now, here is the main issue with this. By saying there is no resurrection, they're saying that Christ is not coming back. Can you see that? I want you to focus on that for a moment now. By getting to a place where they're saying that the resurrection of the dead is not going to happen, they're saying, in essence, that Jesus is not coming back. I don't know about y'all, but the thing I've been hearing people say almost every other week is, "I wish the Lord would come back." The thing I've been hearing people say so often, and many believe even right now, that Jesus Christ is coming back soon, right? And because of all the tragedy, all the death, and all the pain, and all the suffering, many are wishing, "Jesus, please come soon." But if you know your Bible, he's coming when God says so, right? When God is ready, he's going to return. But the dilemma in the church at Corinth was that they had come to a place where they did not believe that Christ was coming back and that the dead would be raised. And I want you to see the significance of this. Go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Because Paul makes it very clear to them that belief or that unbelief was bringing to pass a significant trauma and dilemma within the body of Christ. Because look at verse 13. "For if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised either." Did you get that? I love what Paul does. He makes an intimate and very powerful connection between the resurrection of Christ and the resurrection of the church. Are you seeing that yet? He's saying to us that if there is no resurrection of us, then Christ's resurrection never happened. That sounds crazy, right? I know that sounds like whacked out, but that's what Paul is saying. He is saying that if we are not going to be raised, then was Christ really raised at all? And I want you to see that because it's important to understand that the thing that is coming next is the resurrection of the body of Christ, the return of the Lord. Are you ready for it? That's the thing that I remember. I mean, I remember in days long ago that the old preacher would say, are you ready for Christ's return? And they preached that over and over again, that Christ was going to return. And sometimes they would say, he's coming soon. Remember that? And I would say to my friends later, it's been 40 years. Soon is a long time, right? My point that I try to make to my friends is, yes, he's coming, but only he knows when. But the thing that must be true of you and me is, are we ready for the coming of the Lord? And maybe, my brothers, the dilemma for the Church of Jesus Christ in America is that we forgot that he's coming. Amen. Hear me for a moment. And this is the thing that God woke me up and really kept me up a little bit last night. And that is, could we do the fighting we do if we thought Christ was coming today? Could we devastate, almost literally destroy a denomination if we knew that Jesus was going to return today? Okay, I'll give you another day. Tomorrow. Would we as believers in Jesus Christ be so callous to use our, if you will, minds and intellect to bring down the body of Christ if we knew he was coming back tomorrow? The point I'm trying to make to you is this. There seems to be the missing thing within the body on this resurrection day. That as we war in our churches, and I'm talking about those two churches in particular, but there are wars all over the church, right? You got a war in your church right now, trying to get rid of the pastor, right? And to tell the truth, don't lie about it, right? You got a war in your steward board, a war in your trustee board, a war in your usher ministry, right? Come on now, y'all know it's true. Would we be at war with each other this way if we knew he was showing up tomorrow? And I'm saying this to you because I want you to understand the ramifications of the actions that we're taking even on a daily basis. The things that are happening across the body of Christ, if you will, are affecting not only the church, but those who live around us. I heard a preacher say, and this is crazy, at a general conference, they had to call the police on the preachers at the general conference. Can you imagine that? The only thing I'm trying to say is that if we really believe in the return of Christ, and I do, if we believe that he could come at any moment, and I do, what's really wrong? What is the real issue in the body of Christ? Because we will testify, we will talk about him coming back, but can that really be the truth when the things that are happening are taking place in our body? I was listening to a man, I won't give his name, but he was saying that he has a struggle believing in the church because the church doesn't act like the church of Christ. He has a hard time believing in the message of the church. Because when he looks at the church, it doesn't look like a church that belongs to God. Think about that for a moment. That when someone sees us, they don't see God. They see the opposite of God. That's not the way it's supposed to be, right? Y'all know that. The thing I'm trying to do, and I know it's not making you want to shout today, but what I'm being asked to do by God is to let you know that Christ is coming. I don't know when, but the thing that the church must ask itself, are we ready for the return of Christ? Can we be ready while we're at war? There are those of you who have left your church because you're mad with the pastor. There are those of you who have left your church because you can't handle the deacon board. There are those who have walked away, literally, from the things of God and the house of God, not understanding that God is not finished with them, and yet there they are, away from God, no longer following him. The thing that I'm trying to share with you is that he is coming back. Are you ready? If he split the eastern sky today, would he take you with him? I need you to think about that for a moment. If he split the eastern sky today, would you be gone? Because if you look at 1 Corinthians chapter 50, look at 50. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 50. This is what's coming. What am I saying, dear brothers and sisters, is that our physical bodies cannot inherit the kingdom of God. These dying bodies cannot inherit what will last forever. But let me reveal to you a wonderful secret. We will not all die, but we will be transformed. It will happen in a moment, in the blink of an eye, when the last trump is blown. For when the trumpet sounds, those who have died will be raised to live forever. Did y'all get that? And we who are living will also be transformed, for our dying bodies must be transformed into bodies that will never die. Our mortal bodies must be transformed into immortal bodies. Then, when our dying bodies have been transformed into bodies that will never die, the scripture will be fulfilled. Death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy victory? O death, where is thy sting? The thing I want you to hear is that Jesus is coming back and he's going to take us. The question is he going to take you? The resurrection of Christ is true, but is the resurrection of you true? I want you to think about that because the reality, my friends, is that if it's not true for you, if you do not know God, if you do not know Christ, if you have not accepted the resurrected Christ, then that day when it comes will not be for you. There's a verse I've quoted 1,000 times, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thy heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Your resurrection is sealed if you know the Savior. Did you get that? Your resurrection that will come one day, it's coming. I know it's coming. But let's go back to the 14th verse, because I want you to see the ramifications of what happens if none of these things are true. Back to verse, let's go with 14. Are you there? Somebody say amen. And if Christ has not been raised, then all of our preaching is useless. In other words, I'm wasting my time right now. I'm just speaking words in the air, and the words have no significance. The words have no meaning, because if Christ is not raised, I'm just pontificating and not really sharing anything of substance. Paul says, if Christ is not raised, then the preaching is useless. And then he says something that blows your mind. Your faith is also useless. In other words, you think you have a powerful faith and a wonderful faith, but if the resurrection is not real, there is no faith. I don't know where you see the significance of that, but that if there is no resurrection, we have nothing. Have you thought about that lately? But I'll get to the main point in a minute. Look at verse 15. And we apostles will all be lying about God, for we have said that God raised Christ from the grave. So Paul says, me and my compadres, my colleagues, the other apostles, have become liars. Because what is their message? And that maybe might be the greatest dilemma of all, and that is that the message of the resurrection must become a part of who we are. Has that become a part of who you are? Paul said, we preach the resurrection, but if there is none, then we are lying. So do you believe in the resurrection of Christ? Listen, I want you to think about this for a moment. We celebrate it when? Think about it for a minute. The most important day of the year, and we celebrate it once a year, right? You ever thought about that? Now, y'all pray for the pastor right now, but most of us love Christmas better than Easter. Somebody say, amen, preacher. Tell the truth about it. Somebody say, no. The reality is, think about it for a minute with me. We spend more time, and Lord knows we spend more money. Come on, somebody, help me out. Listen, this is what happened with us. Folk that won't never come to church, they'll come on Christmas. But hear this, folk that you never see during the course of the year, they connect on Christmas, right? Oh, y'all not feeling me, okay. Well, let me put it this way, my family comes on Christmas. I have folk that I never see, that I would never see if there was no Christmas celebration. But Easter, who shows up? Now follow me in this. Now I do have to admit this, that it used to be that on Easter you had your biggest crowds, right? You got the CMEs, I think they call them. Christmas, Easter, and Mother's Day. Somebody remember Mother's Day? The thing I'm trying to get to is that in reality, Christmas has become the main day, but it's not the main day. Okay, don't misunderstand me. I love Christmas. Should I say that twice? I love Christmas, but the resurrection is the main day. Now, we have begun to see resurrection or Easter as a holiday, but in reality, it's a holy day. We have so many rabbits and chocolates and Peter Rabbit, and I'm trying to figure out where the eggs came from. Y'all, I know rabbits don't have eggs, right? But we have all of these things that we have created around Easter, and the reality is this, the main thing of Easter is Christ. And listen to this. This is something God put in my mind the other day. We've been fighting over whether to use Easter or resurrection. Have you noticed that? We're fighting. Listen to this. We've been fighting on the words when everybody, all these folk are going to hell. We fighting on, should we use Easter? Should we use resurrection? Every year you hear, right? For me, Easter has always been resurrection. But here we are. The devil has tricked us to fighting about words. And folk are going to hell while we're fighting over these little words. What is the point I'm trying to make? This is a significant day we have, my friends. And without it, we have nothing. Look at the rest of what Paul says, and I'm almost done. Verse 16, and if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. Verse 17, and if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is useless, and you are still guilty of your sins. In other words, we're bound for hell. Did you see that in that? In other words, if the resurrection is not true, then we are still in darkness. If resurrection is not true, we are still in our sin. I mean, it doesn't get any deeper than that for a dark reality, and that is that without the resurrection, we are still lost. Verse 18, in that case, all who have died believing in Christ are lost. Now, that's real ugly. That our family members that we love, that we are looking forward to seeing, right? I don't know about y'all, but there are people I'm looking. Of course, we're going to look for Jesus first, right? We always say that. Don't we always say that? Because of the holiness of the moment, that we will be looking for Christ first. But I know myself, there'll be people that I'll be looking for in heaven when I get there. And nobody on, one person on that page, maybe a couple of y'all. My point I'm trying to make is, Paul says, if the resurrection is not true, then that will not be true. Are you feeling me? If the resurrection did not happen, then there is no mama time, no daddy time coming in heaven. What I'm trying to show you is the significance of the resurrection of Christ. The resurrection of Christ is everything. Verse 19, and if our hope in Christ is only for this life, we are more to be pitied than anyone in the world. In other words, if we who believe in Christ have spent our lives, spent our energy, spent our resources on the things of God and the things of Christ, and we've talked about the resurrection, and all we have is that we die. He says we are the ones to be most pitied. But I want you to know this. I'm glad Paul put the next verse in. Verse 20. He says in verse, but in fact, I like the way the New Living Translation puts it. In fact, this is the fact, y'all. Don't get it twisted. Christ has been raised from the dead. He is the first of a great harvest of all who have died. And I don't know whether you got the picture. Get the picture in your mind that Christ was the first one, but Paul is saying there are many who are coming after him who will be raised as well. He says there is a great harvest of those who have died who are going to be raised as well. I don't know about you, but I'm ready for that. I'm looking forward to that. I believe that's coming. Do you believe it? I'm asking you that because this is a glorious thing that God has planned for us in the future. And the future might be tomorrow. Anybody feel that? This is an awesome thing that God has set us up for, that He has has made it possible that even when we die, there's going to be a better day. The life that ends here begins a new life there. Anybody understand that? The life that we think is so great here. Y'all, some of y'all having a great life, right? Come on, somebody say amen. Some of us are loving our life here. We are in it to win it. We got it going on. We're getting it done. And we are excited about life. And we want to stay here till we get to be 100, right? Amen, somebody. Come on, let's just be factual. But the reality, my friend, is we all got to go. And if this life is all we have, we literally have nothing. Because the amazing thing about the human existence is that it ends. I have been watching. Have you been watching all the people have been dying? One of the moments this year that I will never forget is I was watching an interview with Cicely Tyson. I don't know how many of y'all saw that, her last interview with Gail, I think her name, Gail Brown, Oprah's friend, right? When Cicely Tyson, I think 94, 95, as she was talking with this lady, I'm thinking she's going to live probably be 100, right? The interview was amazing. If you haven't, look it up on YouTube, you'll find it. The interview with Tyson was amazing, was beautiful, was powerful. She was herself. She was presenting herself in a way that said to me that she was on it. Okay? A few days later, she was gone. And my friends, if this is all we have, but I'm glad that this is not all. I'm excited because God has made a way that you and I, when we leave this plane, that we enter a whole new level, a whole new plane. That when this life ends, we will no longer be controlled and defined by our existence on this planet. So many of us are living lives that are wretched and destroyed and sick and broken. And we don't understand the power of the resurrection. Listen to me. The resurrection of Christ has made it possible for you to not only live here, but to live there as well. Say, where is there? Well, somewhere. It made me think of a song, somewhere out there. The question is, will you be there? Christ has been raised, but will you be raised? Christ died for us and was raised. Is your day coming? One more person I was thinking about, and y'all have to forgive me because I'm a Marvel fan, right? I'll never forget the day that, y'all know his name, Chad Balls. Bozeman, I always have to get his message last name up. When I heard that he had died, it's like, huh? Anybody go, huh? Yeah. I got a couple of hands in the back, head shaking, yeah. It's like, huh? Him? He's gone? He's left this life? But if you watch his videos, I believe he had a faith in Christ. And that even though his life here ended and his life here is gone, he had a journey, he had a place that he was going when it was over. Now, you know what happens when you die. Folk talk about you like you're God, right? Come on, y'all know it. They talk about you. They say things about you that elevate you to a place that you never would imagine being. Amen, somebody? The thing I want you to understand is that as I look at his life in particular, it looked like he was ready to meet God. If you listen to some of his speeches, you'll hear God and Jesus in his statements. My point I'm trying to make is this. If God called you today, where would you be? And if God called you, would you be with me one day? I'm going to be there. I'm going to be. Man, I wish I could say this. So I wish I could fly up. I'm going to be there. I'm going to be in heaven with God. I'm going to be in heaven with the saints of God. I know this is coming. Not because of me, but because of Christ. Because Christ has been raised, I have tomorrow, right? Y'all know what I'm talking about. Because Christ has been raised, I have a future that is one that you can't even begin to imagine. It is beyond our understanding or comprehension what God has prepared for those who love him and who know him. The question you must answer on this Easter Sunday, do you know him? And if you know him, you're covered. You got it made. When he come back, you got it. And the amazing thing, that when he comes, what would he find? I'm saying to my fellow Christians and churches out there, we got to get our act together, man. We really got to get our act together. How can we continue to fight among ourselves and think God is pleased? How can we say we know the risen Christ and we know he's coming back, and yet the devastation that's taking place among us? It's not right. In fact, it's wrong. Your church is being devastated right now, your local church, because you let the devil have his way. Greater is he that is in you than the enemy on the outside. Stand in the word. Stand in the power of the Spirit of God. Stand in the things of God. No matter what the enemy brings, stand for Christ. Because one day, the resurrected Christ is coming back for us to resurrect us. In Jesus' name, amen. Enjoy the resurrection day, Easter day, amen. And celebrate what God has done in bringing Christ back to life. And remember this, our day is coming. One day, because he was raised, you and I will be raised as well. In Jesus' name, let's pray. Father, we thank you for allowing us to celebrate the resurrection of Christ. We thank you that you have allowed us to be a part of this celebration, even in this hour, in this moment. Now, God, send us out. Use us. Strengthen us. Anoint us to spread the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Help us, dear God, to no longer keep it to ourselves, but let men and women, boys and girls, know about the resurrected Christ who died for the sins of the whole world. Oh, God, help us to proclaim it with joy unspeakable and full of your glory. I ask this today in Jesus' precious name. Amen. God bless you. Have a great week in God, and we'll see you next Sunday. On that Sunday, which is the second Sunday, right? Have a great week.